in Lake City. The NHRA was going to have the Southeastern Regional Championships. So everybody wanted to go there. This was going to be really big time drag racing. And national publicity, pictures in Hot Rod Magazine, all of that. So we all went up there, and I, by the grace of God, won the race. I wasn't the fastest, but I was pretty good at leaving the line, and the cars were pretty close, and cars that were actually quicker than me, I actually got the jump on them on the flag. And so I won the race, and there's some pictures here. You can see a Hot Rod later running. And my car was so ugly that they wouldn't run a picture in Hot Rod Magazine. I was really upset about that because I wanted so bad to have a picture of my car in Hot Rod Magazine. And so anyway, about a month later, we had a meeting of the Strokers. And they had taken up a collection and bought a little tea set for my wife and I, which they presented to me at this Stroker meeting, congratulating me on winning the event. Not one person in the club won anything, no class, nothing. They all got beat. But this car won the race. And there's several pictures of it around here of the at the event. And I'll never forget what the president said when he gave me the tea set. He said, "I guess you retire now." And I said, "Gene, this is a tall, blue-eyed, good-looking guy, you know, with a beautiful blonde wife." He said, "I guess you'll retire now." And I said, "Gene, why would I do that?" And he looked at me, looked down at me, and he said, "Because you will never beat the Californians." In other words, I beat these Strokes from the east, but I couldn't go to the west coast. And just exactly almost 1 year from that day, 2 years from that day, we'll move over here. This car was taken to the World Series of Drag Racing in Cordova, Illinois. Here's a picture of it on the return road. It looked a little different. It got modified after that, but there it is on the return road. And I did, in fact, beat the world champion and record holder, Cook and Bedwell. These were the first guys over 160 in a quarter mile. They held the record at 168.22 at that time. They later went 169. And he was so stunned at the event that this car come out of the woods in Florida and put a wheel out in front of this guy, they made me run him again. But I'm sorry, folks, but 996 beats a 10-0 almost every time, especially if you leave good. And that really spurred me into action. I took a real good look at all those cars. At that event, they came from all over the United States, from the east to the west. The Postolian was there. John Bradley was there with the world fastest flathead, and all types of cars. And I looked at them all and what they were doing. I didn't have top speed. I only went 155, and Cook was going 165 to my 155. But the ET was better because I had a two-speed transmission. And I come home and I modified the car to the way it looks right there in this picture. It's not, you can't tell very much difference, but there is some very a lot of differences. And the big difference was fuel delivery. I could tell, listening to the cars run, that they were starving for fuel in the middle of the course. They just couldn't get enough volume into those carburetors. The carburetors could deliver the fuel if they had it, but they couldn't get it the way the people were using the fuel tanks. I came home and I built a great big 2-inch line running out of the fuel tank through a 2-inch diameter, ID diameter fuel shutoff valve into a great big homemade block with the 3/8 hoses coming out of it. And I took the car to Brooksville on November the 10th, 1957, and it went 176 miles an hour. They couldn't believe it. I mean, it was a shot heard around the world in drag racing, because Roger Huntington, the SAE engineer in Detroit, had predicted that no one would ever exceed 169 miles an hour in the quarter using rubber tires on pavement for traction. It was physically impossible to do it. It makes you wonder about some of those suspension bridges, doesn't it? Anyway, the car went through lots of changes, and it ended up with a blower in Chester, South Carolina. On June the 20th, 1959, the blower exploded. I didn't have on any gloves. I didn't have on any face mask. And I was nearly burned to death. They wanted to take my hands off in the Chester Hospital. I told them I'd rather die. My wife brought me to Tampa, and they had a real good burn specialist at the Tampa General it is today. It was Tampa Municipal then. And he saved my hands, obviously, and I had a good career. And I didn't drive the car for about a year. I got it. Art Malone came on board. He drove it for me. But then he decided he wouldn't have his own car, and I didn't blame him for that. We went to school together from the fifth grade, and he wanted to go out on his own, so I took over the driving again. And the first time out, I went to York, Pennsylvania, and lowered his ET record from 826 to 823. So the year off didn't hurt me too bad. But this is my favorite car in the museum. There's lots of cars that are better than this one, but this is the one that I really like the best, because it's built on 31 Chevy frame rails, which I paid $35 for. I had to take them out of the car myself, which was quite a job. And it's still the original frame. The car was never sold. It always stayed in my possession. And these carburetors are the original carburetors that I converted at Cordova on a Saturday night before the race on Sunday when I beat Cook. I changed them over to 100% nitro. I never got rid of those carburetors. I still have them to this day. I came home, we only had six at Cordova, and I changed it to eight. And you can look at this picture, you can see the front carburetor in the picture is brand new. You can buy those carburetors for $6 at the parts house, brand new in those days. Times have changed. Those carburetors today, brand new, are almost $500. Anyway, there's a lot of cars down here that, a lot of experiments. All my ideas didn't work. The Sidewinder was a great idea. This was about torque. About when these cars leave the line, they give a big move like this because it's a tremendous torque. And this took care of that. This made the car plant the wheels and really go good. You could drive this car with one finger. But the problem was there was so much horsepower lost through the gear train that was giving up 21% of my power just to get through the gear train. And you only give up 7% of your power to get to a standard high point rear. So we had to go back to the standard drive because no one can give up 14% of your power. Another experiment, turbine. I was a Navy recruiter for 30 years, and we got this idea about using a helicopter motor. It's supposed to be 2,000 horsepower, and it's really lightweight, all titanium and aluminum. But I don't believe it ever made 2,000 horsepower, because at 2,000 horsepower should have made this car go faster than it did. And then, plus that, it didn't make any noise, and so it wasn't something that the public really liked. Right behind you is a really fantastic car. This is Swamp Rat 6, and this is B. This car was originally built for Art Malone, and I had built, this was the first of the round back cars with the swoopy tail section. And the first one was Swamp Rat 5, which we cut the tail off and put the round section on. It was a square back car. That car, we made a recreation. It's in the other room. And so Malone got the first car off the jig with the new configuration. They used to be square backs. And he didn't do well in California. And we both got back to Tampa about the same time, and Spencer Krumholtz had a car on the jig. He was going to get number three. And he rolled into town, and I came in with the Swamp Rat 6, what I call A, and he saw the full car with all the paint. He says, "I don't want that car on the jig. I want a complete car. How much are you going to charge me just to give me your car like it is?" I said, "Well, that would be $7,500. He said, "Here's the money." So he rolled out of there with my car, Swamp Rat 6A. And Malone comes in. He says, "Where's your car?" I said, "I sold it to Spencer Krumholtz." He says, "What's that on the jig?" I said, "Well, that was Krumholtz's car. That's going to be mine now." "Oh," he says, "you found out something. I want that car on the jig." I said, "You got a good car, Art. It was the first one off the jig. I don't want it. I want that one on the jig." "Okay, but I'm going to get your body." So he'd had a body built for it. So Malone took the car off the jig, and I took Malone's car. He took all his motor and stuff out of it. Down the road he went. And I took Malone's car and stripped the paint off of it, put my motor in it. And this car won the U.S. Nationals. This is the car first official 204. It set the British land speed record at 197 miles an hour. And it won the U.S. Fuel and Gas Championships at Bakersfield, California in 1965. And I had it sold to these kids. I come home from Bakersfield, they were waiting for it. And they gave me a call from Great Meadows. I like Great Meadows, they were nice people. They said, "Big Daddy, you got to come up here and do one race for us right away. We got a big race coming up, and the guy that we hired couldn't show up. Can you come next weekend?" I said, "Sure." So I told the kids, "You can have the car as soon as I get back. I got to go do this last show." The parachute loop on the 200-mile-an-hour run broke, and it's a real short track, and the railroad track's at the end. And I flipped the car over the railroad tracks. Not real hard, you know, but just enough to tweak it. I just found a picture in my files of the car laying up outside. I hadn't even got out of it yet. And so I come back, it was tweaked a little, and the guys were really upset. And they said, "We want our money back." And I'm so glad they did that, because we just stored it. And in 1986, we straightened the chassis and repaired it. And we have the original car, which is really nice. This is Swamp Rat 10, but from here back is Swamp Rat 8, the first car to have the 426 Hemi. When we come back from Bakersfield, Chrysler, I've been with Chrysler since 1961, they said, "We don't want you in that 392 car anymore. We don't make those kind of engines. We want you in the 426 car." I said, "That ain't as fast." This car was running 210 miles an hour, 7.75 seconds at California, and this was running 8.0s, 192 miles an hour. I mean, that's a lot faster in drag racing. But my boss, Frank Wiley, said, "It's a better engine. Get in it, tune it, you'll like it." One whole solid year, I struggled with that 426 engine, because I just wouldn't put any spark lead in it. Because when you put spark lead in the 392, it ruins it. You only make one run. You could only run 34 degrees. So in my mind, I thought the 34 degrees was what nitro liked. And see, gas even used a little less. So I would never put any more than 34 degrees in this engine, and it just didn't like that. So finally, in an act of desperation, I bumped it to 40 degrees at Rockford, Illinois, and the thing went 213 miles an hour in 7.51 seconds. And we pulled the pan, and it looked like brand new. And I said, "Oh my God, what have we got?" So I bumped the mag up another 10 to 12 degrees, and it was 52 degrees, and just that happened to be the magic number. That's what they go through the lights today at 52 degrees. And the thing ran 219 miles an hour in 7.31 seconds. And we knew then we had to have another car. So this car was real heavy. It was 2 years old. It was, like I told you, it's 8 back here and 10 up here. So we built 11.
Unbelievable.
And this was a super lightweight car, taking advantage of the 426 engine. This car went to Indianapolis. It won the race. It went 6.77 seconds just for absolute unbelievable. And it did it when it needed to do it on the final run against James Warren. And we won the race. And I qualified at that event at 23 out of a 32-car field. And, you know, anybody that far down the list usually don't have a chance. But as the race went on, I got faster and faster. And finally, in the final run, it went 6.77. And that we had grown a beard because this car was built in 72 hours, and we didn't shave. And so we swore we weren't going to shave until the car went in the sixth. And the old first six was on that final run. There I'm shaving the beard at Indianapolis in 1967. It was one of the memorable moments in drag racing. They have a big billboard painting up in Indianapolis of the several of these kind of events that happened there, and this was one of them. This was a big deal. Right behind you is another big deal. This is Front Red 22. This is the first car over 250 miles an hour, and the record stood for 7 full years. And it did that with a 5.63 ET. We also went into that race the underdog because Gary Beck was supposed to be the last word in drag racing. And I have his helmet and his uniform from that year there. And he was running good. But the record was hanging around 249 miles an hour. Nobody could get over that 250 mark. And at Ontario, California, on a time trial run, it went 250.69, 5.63 seconds, both ends of the record, and I had to back up the ET the next day, but I won the race and backed up the round. And like I said, the record stood for 7 years. And we came home. I had built a special engine. It was a high compression engine. It used lots of nitro. But it was really hard to keep it together. We put lots of parts in it to keep it running. So I took the engine out of the car, I put it in the shop, and I put a big tarp over it and tied a rope around it. And I told the guys, don't open up this package for no reason. And I went back to my other combination, which I could run on and on, because I had to do match races. And I had to make a living I couldn't make a living blowing up my engines. And so I had to go back to a more reliable combination, because the problem was we didn't have big enough fuel pumps yet. And if you run it, we run with this, that's only like a 17-gallon pump right there. Did you know that today they run 110-gallon pumps on these cars? And we were running 17 gallons. It's not very much fuel. And this is the car that changed drag racing right here. Changed the whole world of drag racing. It come real close to taking my life. It had a two-speed transmission in it. At the U.S. Fuel and Gas Championships in New York National Speedway in 1969, I determined that we should have a two-speed transmission. The cars would pull out there and they'd pull down. And then they pull up. And I raced the Ram Chargers in the final. And they just almost got by me right there. And then my engine come back up. So on the road out of there, I told Tommy, that's TC right there, TC Lemons, I said, we need a two-speed. He said, where are you gonna get something like that? I said, somebody in California is experimenting with one. I heard about it. So I called Bruce Crower and I said, is that guy that has the two-speed transmission, is he down around San Diego down your way? And he said, yeah, I know the guy personally. He's a friend of mine, Leonard Evan. And this was the beginning of Lenco. That's what Lenco Transmission was, Leonard Evan. So I called Leonard on the phone and I told him, I'd like to help. Does he make a two-speed? He says, I only made one. It's in my car. I says, will you loan it to me? Sure, he says. I'd love to have you out there running. He says, I might go in the transmission business. So he sent me his two-speed. We put it in there. And I told everybody it was a reverser. And so in those days, the crew would be waiting for you out on the track, and you make the burnout, and they'd run out and push you back. So I wouldn't make long burnouts. I'd make short burnouts, and I wouldn't have the crew out there. And then I'd wave my arms that, you know, I couldn't get it in reverse, and they'd run out and pull me back. And I got away with that for about 3 months before anybody began to suspect something. And it all happened at Indianapolis during a Goodyear tire test. At a race with lots of noise going on, you can't tell it. But when it was quiet and just one car, you could hear the thing go, ooh. And so I was tire testing with Perdomo. It's so funny. And the Hawaiian was his crew chief, Roland Leon. And I was running about a half a second quicker than them in ETs. And they was watching my car trying to figure out what was going on, you know. And so he goes down there and makes this real good run, and he goes, ooh. And Perdomo says, what the hell was that? And Roland says, the son of a bitch has got a two-speed in there. And Roland said, and Snake, you might as well withdraw your entry from Indy right now, because you ain't going to get nothing but your ass out run. And the Snake just bolted across the parking lot. There was a payphone and the pits at that time. That's when there was phones on the walls, you know. And he's calling out all West Coast and Shore. They found Leonard Evan just like I did. And in the meantime, Leonard had already started making a new transmission. And so he shipped that next new one to the Snake. And I got mad about that, because my transmission was all iron and stuff and experimental. And I thought that Leonard should have given me the nice transmission and told me to give the Snake mine, you know. But he didn't do that. He gave the Snake the really nice trick, the aluminum case transmission. And he had it at Indy. And he did. He won the race with the thing. And so that kind of peeved me, and I decided the thing was based on, believe it or not, on an overdrive out of a 49 Ford. And I thought, that's not very much of a deal, you know. I knew all about those overdrives. I'd rebuild them before. And I told my friend Ed Stoffels at Quartermaster Industries in Chicago, I said, couldn't we take the insides of a nice torque flight and make our own two-speed transmission that would be better than that overdrive unit? Oh yeah, we can do that. So me and Ed Stoffels got together and we built, you can see there's one right there. We called it a garlic drive. That's a complete one. You see it together. The only problem was it had a little thin sprag in it. That's how it worked, with a sprag in the overdrive 49 Ford. Overdrive was a little different situation. It wouldn't flip over backwards. It was some ball bearings. Where this transmission, this sprag was a little different made. And in Long Beach, on that real hard leave on the final in 1970, March the 8th, the sprag flipped over and the engine free wound, and that sent the drum somewhere towards 30,000 RPM. In other words, the drum went three times whatever the engine was turning. And so as the engine went toward 10,000 somewhere on that way, as that drum went up, it couldn't take it. And it split into two great big pieces, like two great big blades. They come apart, and it imagine a two-tooth saw turning 25,000 RPM. And of course, I'd stepped down on the throttle, so it's whacked off the front of my foot. But this one got saved because I'd let the clutch up, so all I got was some broken bones in my foot from the pieces flying around in the cockpit. And you can see all the mess in there. And there, I got one piece on that far end, is one half of the drum. And I don't know whether that's the half that cut my foot off or the piece that got away. The piece went way up into the sky and out into the field. We never found that. And in the hospital, I'd seen her engine cars. There'd been a lot of engine cars in my time. My brother and I even had one in 1957. They were just evil handling things. You get out in the course and they'd run off the drag strip. And there'd been some that run pretty good, but and none could compare to what these cars could do. These cars were the epitome of drag racing. And they were reliable and they were fast and easy to drive. And where the engine car is not like that, it's a little more temperamental and sensitive to the steering. But in the hospital, suffering with that foot, I said, somehow we've got to get the driver from behind all that mess. Because in these days, all of the rear and the drive shafts and all were just standard automotive parts. Today they set over that stuff, you know, the funny car and all, but it's all special made stuff, great big shafts and stuff. We didn't have that kind of stuff then. It's a dangerous place to be in 1969. So I designed the rear engine car. It was real easy. We just cut all this off and put the roll cage in the seat right there. But it wouldn't go straight. For 3 months, we struggled with that thing. And I never got down the quarter mile one time. And I couldn't believe it because I was at Indianapolis in 1964 when Jim Clark was runner up to Parnelli Jones with a rear engine car and they were moving around 200 miles an hour in traffic. And I couldn't believe it. I couldn't go straight for a quarter of a mile and they could maneuver in traffic. What was wrong? But finally, about 2 weeks before time to go to California, it looked like it wasn't going to work. So me and the boys snapped together a nice new slingshot. I mean, it was a trick thing. And no transmission, it's going to be high gear. And my wife come out in the shop and she saw it. And she flew into a rage. She said, "What is that?" I said, that's my car for 1971. I said, "I got to be in California in 2 weeks. The AHRA, it was a $100,000 contract with them. 10 races, $10,000 a race. It's nothing to be sneezed at back in those days." She said, "You would get back in one of these things after it's mutilated you like this?" I said, "Honey, this is what I do. It don't have a transmission." She said, "Transmission?" She said, "You got 6 friends were killed in these cars in the last 2 years, and not one of them had a transmission. There's 100 things back there to kill you. Now get back on that rear engine project." She was 5'2", I tell you, she was a feist. And Tommy and Connie Swingle were hid behind the Swamp Rat 15, the slingshot we had just built. They were over like this. And We got the engine. We had a tarpaulin over the engine car, so we went back out to Orlando for another day, and it ran off the drag strip just like it always did. And we're coming back from Orlando, and I'll never forget, Swingle was driving, and DC was sitting in the middle of the bench seat, just when they had bench seats in trucks, not bucket seats. And I was riding shotgun, and I had my hat down like this. And I said, "If I didn't know better, I think the steering was too fast, but that can't be it because we took the steering right off the slingshot, just exactly the way it was. And the slingshot goes straight as an arrow." And Swingle said, "But Gar, this ain't a slingshot. This is a front driver. If you think the steering's too fast, let's just slow it down." So that night we took the pitman arm. That's the pitman arm right here. And we shortened that, and then we lengthened the little arms on the spindles, made them longer. Went back to the track the next day. I couldn't believe it. You'd be going down the track and do a little wiggle, and you just automatically correct it, and it run off the track. Well, it did that little wiggle just like it always did, and I corrected it, and it straight as a string. And what was so good, it went 6.86. Now, that don't mean too much to you people right here, but the Ram Chargers had just won a big race at this track about a month before, which I didn't even go over because we didn't have a car, and they set the track record at 6.85. So we're 100th off the track record with the Ram Chargers, which were the ET Kings. And we weren't even trying to run any nitro. We were just running like 75%. We couldn't get in the trailer fast enough and get to California. Of course, we won the Winter Nationals. We won the U.S. Fuel and Gas Championships. And it was the beginning of a whole new era for drag racing. And we didn't have a wing yet, and that's real funny about it. So let's move over there to this car that we're talking about.
I know which one it is. That's that one over there.
Keep going this way. I don't know why it's so far away.
Ah, this is great. This is great.
This is the little darling that's so dear to my heart. And it's so funny. All the time that we were trying to make this car go straight, we never thought about the steering. We were working with all kinds of stuff back here. We thought the problem was in the back of the car, and the problem was all up here. And what it is we have that steering box is way up in the front, and that's where the piston arm is, and then there's the arms we lengthen down on the bottom. So anyway, we come back from California, and I had a conversation with Jim Hall. Does anybody know who Jim Hall is?
Chaparral.
He's the rear engine chaparral guy for sports car racing. He introduced the rear engine car to sports car racing, and he had a little airfoil on the back of his chaparral cars. So I sat on the plane after I won the Winter Nationals. I flew home to be with the family because it was going to be 2 weeks before it was time for the Bakersfield race. And Jim Hall was sitting beside me, and I just won the race. And he couldn't stop talking about the fact that I had this rear engine car now. And he knew that eventually drag racing would go to rear engine, but he just didn't know who was going to do it. But it was so wonderful that I did it. And he said, when the smoke clears, you'll have a little airfoil over the rear wheels. And so I got home, and Swingle was, we was already making cars for, we had two orders. We was building a car for Karamasinas, which is right on the other side of the wall, and we built one for Tom McEwen. And I could have bought that years ago, and I should have, but I didn't. It was a little low on cash. So he said, did you see anybody exciting out there? And it just so happened that Swingle's, one of his heroes, was Jim Hall. I said, I sat on the plane with Jim Hall all the way from Los Angeles to Dallas. Oh, what did he have to say? I said, he talked my ear off about the range and car. And he said, when the smoke cleared, we'd have a little airfoil over the rear wheels. Oh, did he? And that was it. That was the end of the conversation. So it wasn't, I ran the Bakersfield race. I won that race. And the phone rang when I got home. It was Jim Tice. And he says, I've added a race to the schedule. It's West Palm Beach, and it's on April something. And I looked at my calendar. I said, I got a match race Saturday night in Shuffletown, North Carolina that day, Jim. I said, what I can do, I can come down to West Palm Beach, and I'll qualify the car as good as I can on Friday. And then I'll pull out and go to the North Carolina, and I'll run the race, and I'll call you Saturday night and see if I'm still in the program. And if I am, we'll rush down there to West Palm Beach, and we won't have any trouble getting back for the race, because you don't start the first round until about 1:30, because it's only an 8-car field. He said, that's fine. I appreciate you not wanting to, you know, just winch out on a contract, because, you know, they put advertising out. It's not a good idea to not show up. So We go to Shuffletown to race Ivo. No wing. And Ivo beats me three straight. The little car would shoot out there, but then the track was slick. It wasn't like those nice tracks in Pomona and Bakersfield. And here come Ivo, that big, heavy slingshot. It weighed about 1,800 pounds. And it would get a grip, see, and it just come lumbering by me. There was nothing I could do about it, just spinning the wheels. So he beats me three straight. So we get down to Mount Jackson. I called Jim Tyson. He said, yeah, you're still in the program. Come on down. So we got to Mount Jacksonville, and I'm bitching, you know, damn, what am I going to do? I mean, it's great having a nice rear-engine car, but I got to win these ranch races. My life, my livelihood was the match races. And Swingle said, I guess it's time we put that little wing on it that Jim Hall was talking about. I said, yeah, that'd be great. I said, that's the first thing we'll do Monday morning when we get through with the race. And they said, I was thinking about right now. I said, what? He said, yeah, the way I figure it, TC's already got all the bucks made. That's these pieces inside the ribs. And he said he's working on the little machine to bend this piece here. He said, if you and I work real hard, we'll build all the superstructure to hold it up there. He said, the way I figure it, if we work all night and drive straight through them down there, we can get there before they get the last pair off. I said, let's do it. So this is what we built. You're looking at the pieces. And we got there. I put the fire suit on the interstate. And we rolled in, and they was firing the pair before the guy singled. He was waiting to do his single. We rolled out of the trailer right to head of staging. We just put 100% nitro in the tank because it had fuel in it, and we just topped it off. I jumped in the car. We didn't warm it or nothing. And the car was 10 miles an hour faster and a quarter of a second quicker than it had ever been with the wing. And that solidified the rear-engine car. It was now a super racer, not just in the field. At Indianapolis, it went 6.21 seconds, and the field was 660s. That's how much quicker it was. And it changed the whole world of drag racing, and it made it so much safer. It's been over 50 years now since all that happened, and they haven't killed six in the 50 years, much less the six that was killed in the 6 years, the 2 years coming up to my race. While we're standing right here, I have to tell you about this little car. It's Tommy Ivo's twin engine car. This is the car that held the record for gasoline at 180 miles an hour even. And I jumped in Connie Coletta's car that's sitting down there as a bounty hunter. And I went 180.36. And I took the record away from him. And Bernie Podridge blurted out over the PA system, well, we're going to have to call him Big Daddy from now on. And that's where the Big Daddy name come from. From taking the record away from this car at U.S. Nationals in 1962. And becoming the fastest car on gas. I found this car in a field out by the Bithlow drag strip. Billy Herndon had bought it from Tommy Ivo, and he had a crash with it and got hurt, and he just put it out there in the field. And I saw it out there, and I said, it was just raining on it. And I said, Billy, what will you take for that car? He says, give me $5,000. I said, fine. So I gave him $5,000, and we brought it here. We cleaned it up a little bit, but it was a little shaky looking. You know, it had some rust and all, but we polished it up. It looked pretty good. And then they had a special presentation at the NHRA Drag Racing Museum in California, and they had an Ivo exhibit that was going to last a year. So Ivo said, can I borrow my car? And he said, if you let me borrow it, we'll take it completely apart and redo all the chrome and everything so it looks just like it did when I raced it. So I loaned it to him, and they fixed it up. He really did a nice job on it, because he's one of the most famous guys in drag racing. Let's go right down here. A number of years ago, Citgo Gasoline did a survey, a national survey. Who was the most famous drag racers? And Force was running at the time, of course, not like he is now. This is like 15 years ago. I was number one, Charlie was number two, and Don Perdomo was number three in the national survey. Perdomo had a kind of a bad time for about a year in his career. And he'd had a lot of his cars, but he ran out of money. And Don Perdomo lived a pretty high lifestyle. He has a 30,000 square foot home, and the taxes alone are pretty tough on that. And he called me on the phone one day. He said, "I got three cars I want to get rid of: the Army car, the Wedge car, and the Wind's Winder, the yellow slingshot." He said, "I want $20,000 for the three cars." He says, "They don't run, they got dummy engines, but they look like they'd run." I said, "How do you want the money?" He said, "I need it wired to me. I got some bills that's got to be paid." So I wired him $20,000, and I sent the guy that used to drive Tommy Ivo's Wagon Master, the four-engine Buick car. He was out in California, worked for Mayflower. I said, "Go over to Perdomo's and pick up those three cars and bring them to me." So they brought them over to me. Of course, we all know that now that was a really good deal. I mean, any one of these three cars with a running engine in it, which wouldn't be hard to do, because you got all the external parts, you just have to put a live engine in, would go across the block at the Barrett Jackson anywhere from $300,000 to $500,000, no problem. And then a guy called me from New Jersey, and this was Perdomo's brand new car for 1971 when I introduced the rear engine car. And so you know what happened there. This car never got run that much. They had to get a rear engine car. And this guy in New Jersey bought this car, and he had it backfired and burned him a little bit, so he never ran it. He sold me this one for $6,000 complete, and it was all apart, but it was a complete car. So I got four of Perdomo's cars, which are worth a fortune. But we don't sell nothing here. Like, we don't care what they're worth. We save these cars for posterity. This is about the history of the sport. And you would be amazed at how many people come here and they want to know before they buy the ticket, are there any Perdomo cars? Is there any Force cars? How about Shirley Muldowney? And we got them all. We got the largest collection of Muldowney cars and Perdomo cars in the world. This is the Streamliner section. This is some of Jocko's work here. This car went 854 seconds way back in 1959, which was a fabulous ED, but they had a problem with the canopy, and Jazzy Nelson drove it, and he got hurt with the canopy, and he wouldn't drive it anymore. And it's hard to work on these kind of cars, but when I had the engine car, I had so much success with it, Jocko insisted that we build this car for a Streamliner. But it took a while to get it going, but I took it to California, to Orange County, and went 185 miles an hour, and everybody else was running like 230, and I had Butch Moss driving it, and then we brought it back to Lakeland, and had Don Cook come in and drive it. He's a pretty much of a daredevil, and still run about 180 miles an hour, and I said, "This car should be going faster than 180 miles an hour," and Don said, "That's just all it'll do, Don." And he said, "It does something funny down the course, and I always live." I said, "Give me the fire suit. I want to take it for a spin." So I barrel down through there, and it's running pretty good. but not like a slingshot because it's so heavy. And about 180 miles an hour, the motor revved up. And then the car did a little funny, you lift a minute, the motor lifts up, and then you felt it do something, like it landed. And what it was doing, at about 180 miles an hour, we'd get a cushion of air underneath it, and it would run up on this, it would hydrofoil up on this cushion of air, and the motor would rev up, and then of course you back off. And of course, as soon as the wheels left the ground, then that slowed it down, and then it would flop back down. And I knew right then it was already too much trouble to work on it. So we canceled the project. And Jocko never forgave me for it. He went to his grave saying that I sabotaged the whole project because I didn't want him to be the guy that designed the world's fastest dragsters. And it wasn't the furthest thing from the truth. And I sold it to Russell Mendez, the guy that got killed at Gainesville in his rocket car. He was going to put a rocket engine in it, but he got killed before he got a chance to do that. And I bought the whole thing back from the estate because in the meantime, I started the museum and I wanted all my cars back. I don't know why it was so hard to see that wind sticker.
I don't know either. You know why?
Nobody could see that.
I was looking for the late winds.
No, that's the original one. Wind.
Yep.
This car is the Swamp Rat 3. This happens to be the... This would be C. There was A, B, C. And the reader was A, B, C because they got crashed. And this was my first big sponsor, Winds Friction Proofing. This is the first chrome moly car in drag racing, Healy arc welded. And for some strange reason, I never drove one of the Swamp Rat 3s. Swingle drove them all. Because I hurt myself just before this race in Detroit. And we finished this car up real quick. And Swingle went to Detroit and won the match race against Art Malone, and that started his driving career. There's a picture of him there, and that's his ashes in that urn right there. And it's so funny. Swingle must have quit working for me 5 or 6 times. He'd go to California, he'd go out here, he'd go fish, he'd do it. He was a free spirit. He was so funny. My wife came here with me, and she said, "What's in that silver urn?" I said, "That's Swingle's ashes." She said, "You finally got him, didn't you?" And there's a nice picture. That's me letting him go. That's me standing behind the car in the picture. Look at the wheels up. That's when drag racing was really something different than it is today. There was a lot of showmanship in it. And the car never went 200 miles an hour, but it got close. I think this one got all the way up to 199. And that's a tribute to Tommy Lemons. Tommy Lemons always wanted a cackle car. And he had a little garage in Bixby, Oklahoma before he came to Florida to work for Swingle. And then I took him away. I sold him away from Swingle. He was so good. And he was... This is a Woody Gilmore chassis. And a guy come in the driveway out here with this chassis one day, and he wanted $2,000 for it, and I bought it. And Tommy says to me one day, he says, "I really want to build a cackle car to take like the Bowling Green." He says, "Can I buy that chassis from you?" I said, "Sure." So he gave me the $2,000. And this is one of the latest one of Woody. See how high the roll cage sets? Woody was getting the driver up over the engine, which was a really good idea. See, the driver can see real nicely right over the injector. That's a 300 cubic inch Chrysler engine. It's made from a polysphere engine, and you put Hemi heads on it. And Tommy was into this program, had everything just about ready to go when he had his heart attack. And so I finished the project for him. And I tell you, that because that thing is only 300 cubic inches, It really had some lower pressure. The flames, you ought to see him sticking out of the pipe. He was going to have a really nice tackle car. This is a recreation of the Cook and Bedwell car that Emory Cook himself built to run exhibition runs with. The original car was sold to some kids in Kansas, and then they sold it to some kids, and they put a flathead in it, and then they didn't like it anymore. It's a chassis research car built on exhaust pipe tubing, and so it wasn't very important, so they just threw it in the dumpster, not realizing that in the future, the history of that would really be serious. So Emory built this car. I helped him with it. I got lots of parts. I supplied him for it. And he built this car, and he took this thing to Carlsbad, and he duplicated his run. He went 168.22 in this car, just like he did in the original car, which he did that at Colton. And so Emory died. He had a heart attack. And the kid, the son, Ernie, loaned it to the museum. And then we had this problem a number of years ago. This guy was going to build this great big museum in Reno. Ralph Whitworth was his name. And he come through here unannounced, quietly, and he wrote down everybody's car in here. He wrote down the car and the name of the people. And then he was a multimillionaire. And he would call the people up and he'd say, do you own the car or is it on loan? And they'd say, it's on loan. And he'd say, well, I'll give you this for it, or I'll give you so much for it. And he'd just buy these cars at big money. And so I called Ernie, this was on loan. Most of these cars belong to me, but this one and this one didn't belong to me at the time. So I called Ernie up and I told him what was going on. And I said, I'd really like for your dad's car to stay in this museum. What will you take for it? And I said, this guy's liable to offer you more. But I said, we would be happy to give you $20,000 for it. He said, I would rather take the $20,000 and stay in the museum. So I sent him $20,000 and we got the car. The Shirley car, I picked this car up at 20th Century Fox. It was all in pieces. After this is the car in Heart Like a Wheel. And I called Shirley and I said, you know, you're going to be getting a call from Miss Ralph Whitworth. He's going to be wanting to try to buy this car from you. I said, what will you take for it? She said, I'll take $50,000. I said, okay. We sent her the check. You see her helmets up there? That's every helmet she ever wore. One, you see the one in there where she got burned so bad? See it burned. That's where she nearly got burned to death. And right in here somewhere is the one she crashed in 1984. She didn't want these helmets broke up. She wanted them to go out she had lots of people offer her as much as $10,000 for one of these helmets, and she wouldn't sell it. But she sold me the whole set for $50,000 if I would promise to display them with her car. So we built, my guy Chris here built these cabinets and we put them up there, and I'm really proud of this because it's not often that a racer keeps every one of their helmets, you know, to keep them as a group like that. She had some pretty helmets, didn't she?
Yeah.
We didn't get along in the beginning, me and her. We had lots of fights, but after she had the big wreck at Montreal, it was heavy on my heart that I hadn't talked nice to her, you know, and I had my share. I'm a little hot-headed myself, especially when I was younger.
No.
And I called her on the phone and wished her the best, and I prayed for her. And she's a remarkable woman. And she'd come back from that wreck. There's not many people would ever drive a car again after that horrendous accident that she had. And she actually came back and won a national event after that. And I take my hat off to her. And I have her last ride in the other room. And we owned that one before she won the race, when we knew that was going to be our last race at Pomona 2003. We'd already paid for the car. When she stepped out of the car on the last run, the car belonged to the museum. And we have it just like it was. She made the run. It's another artifact. This was Swingle's best ride. This is Swamp Rat 7. He never run national events, but he crashed this car at US 30. It wasn't bad. It just kind of run off the strip and got bent up a little bit. So Swingle didn't want to come home and have me repair this car. He wanted a brand new one. So what he did, he took the engine out and the rear out and some of the front pieces off, and the frame he just left there by the dumpster. And some kid took it home. This is in 1964. About 1995, at a Super Chevy meeting in Indianapolis, this man walks up to me and he says, "I have Swamp Rat 7's frame at my house. Do you want it?" I said, "Are you kidding?" I said, "Where did you get it?" He said, "It was by the dumpster in US 30 after Swingle turned over. It just kind of tumped over you. It wasn't real bad. And it tweaked it a little bit." And he said, "I took it home and saved it. It's in my garage. If you can have it if you want it." I said, "Oh my God, what a treasure." So we went over and got it. We did have to put the new front half on it because it was, the frame rails were bent up there, but all the original stuff is nice. And I always, Swingle had that special scoop right there. That's a real rare scoop. And I always had that. I never let that get away. So the frame and the scoop are original. Of course, the engines, you know, they're all just 392s. And this was the first car off of the jig, the Ridget cars, after mine that you see over there. And the next one was Tom McEwen. And he took it down to Baton Rouge and had Lester Gilroy make this real swoopy body. But it was too heavy. It didn't do what they thought it was going to do. And they actually ran the car most of its life without the wedge. But I thought it would be so nice to display it with the wedge because it's so unusual. And that it's a tribute to Lester Gilroy of the fine craftsmanship that he was able to do. But the Greek and I have always been really very good friends. And I'm trying to get his trophy. He won the AHRA Nationals at Great Bend in 1959. He beat us in the final. And the trophy stands about this high. It's a beautiful thing. It's pink gold. Must have cost thousands of dollars for the association. And they presented three of them. Cook and Bedwell got one. I got one in 58. And Greek got one in 59. Then they didn't do it anymore. I called him about a month ago and I said, "Where's that trophy?" I said, "It belongs in the museum." He said, "I just gave it to my daughter." And I called her up and I said, I said, "That trophy belongs in the museum with the Greek's car." I said, "That's one of the most beautiful trophies that was ever presented in drag racing." And she said, "Well, I'll think about it." I said, "Well, I wish you would, because it really belongs here." So she's thinking about it. She lives in Florida now. This is Bob Sullivan's car. He beat me for the final at the AHRA event in 1960 at Kansas City. This is the car that outran us. And he never did anything with it. After that event, he took it home and he decided to get into funny cars. He had lots of funny cars. And this car sat in his garage and the chrome kind of started peeling off. And I went over to Kansas City and he come out to, this is when we were racing at Independence. He come out to the track to see me. He didn't race anymore. He was older than me. He said, "You know, I still got my purple car." I said, "You do?" He said, "Yeah, would you like to have it for the museum?" I said, "Oh yeah, we'd love that, Bob." And so we did have to repaint it and redo the chrome, but it was a really nice car. And you can see, it's really very dangerous. You know, if you crashed, that wouldn't be much protection back there. But we had an old saying in those days, this is kind of like a sprint car. And I'll never forget the time I walked into this old man's shop in Tampa, and he had his sprint car sitting in the window. And it was kind of like this. And I said, boy, it looks to me like if you had a wreck, you could get hurt. And I know the old man, he wiped his hands and laid the shop towel on the bench, and he come over to me and he said, "Sonny, if you see anything on this car that scares you, the best thing you could do is go right home to your mommy, because men drive these cars and we ain't afraid of nothing." And so I use that line. They'd be talking about new rules and they want to put some chicken shit thing on the car, you know? And I'd say, "If anything on these dragsters scares you, boys, just go on home to your mommy, because men drive these cars and we're not afraid of nothing." I used that line many times when they're talking about wrapping silver tape around the shoulder harnesses and stuff like that, you know, silly stuff, not important stuff. But I do have to say one thing. The car in the back room, Swamp Rat 31, because I had a canopy on it, they made me put a fire bottle on the car. They demanded it in HRA. So all my canopy cars had fire bottles. But I put the fire bottle way up front to use it for weight to hold the front end down. See? Should have the fire bottle right in the cockpit where it belongs. Now, in Spokane, Washington, it did this giant wheel stand about 230 miles an hour, and then it flipped over backwards. I mean, it really tore up the parachute, tangled all in the wreckage, and the whole bunch of mess just skidded down the track, 3,000 or 4,000 feet, Spokane, a real long track. So, and fortunately, I was okay. We ended upside down, way down at the end. I couldn't get out of the car because I was trapped and it was in the dirt. And here come the nitro out of the fuel lines are now above me, and it's all run down in my face and in the cockpit. And I'd say, "Oh, dear God, don't let them exhaust pipes. Don't get anywhere near that exhaust pipe nitro." And I hadn't even got it out of my mouth good, and the whole cockpit's in flames. And I can't get out. And I'm upside down, and I'd say, "I wonder if the fireball and all is still up there." I reached up and I slapped the button, and the cockpit filled with halon. I'm telling you, it brings tears to my eyes. You look at that car, I don't know how the cable stayed intact, nor the quarter inch aluminum tubing that brought the halon back to the cockpit. And it filled the cockpit and the fire went out. And a couple of minutes later, the safety crew got there. I would have been burned to death if the line had been severed or the cable had been severed in any way. And you look at that car, you just don't know how it did. But sometimes those safety things are a good idea.
This is some good stuff.
This is probably one of the best cars I ever built. Swamp Rat 25 was a real poor excuse for a car. It was too heavy. And so in the fall of 1980, I personally built this car in my garage at Sefner. I may have did all the body. That's all black anodized, no paint to save weight. And this car was a killer. It ran from 1981 to the end of 1984. And that's when I was moving up here in the museum. And I didn't do much racing in it. It's a few HRA events, but hardly any NHRA events. And I got all moved in up here, and it's about August, and I just finished building my house. I built a house and lived the time to it. I contracted it myself. I hired my subs and ran the whole project myself. That's the house up on the corner up there. And Art Malone walks into my office and he said, "Let's go to Indy. It's August." I said, "Sounds like a good idea. I'll call up and get us some tickets." He says, "I ain't talking about watching." He says, "I want to race." I said, "I ain't got anything to race with. All my cars are obsolete." "Nah," he says, "just go out there in the museum and pick the best one, and I'll buy the latest trick motor and clutch assembly, and we'll go to Indy. So I got all the new stuff. It was really new stuff. This is when Maglisi was experimenting with all the lockup clutches and stuff. So I got all that stuff and a nice new fresh engine. We put it in this car. We went to Indy. And they were laughing at us. They said, "We're just a couple old dinosaurs coming up here." And they pitted us way out in the grass. We didn't even get a pit spot on the hard pan. And on the third run, we set top speed of the meet. And I'll tell you what, it got their attention. Long story short, we won that event. And Malone said that there was one more race, the finals. It wasn't like today, we have 24 races. He said, "Let's go to Pomona to the final." I said, "Art, we can't take that motor and clutch. That's all used up. Got to have new motor and clutch." He said, "Here's another $20,000. That's all it cost in those days. Put a new fresh motor. This thing went to Pomona. And we won again. And we beat Beck in the final." And Malone said, "You ain't got any business being retired. Let's get a sponsor and go racing." So we got Super Shops. And I built Swamp Rat 29 right in that garage back there. Again, all by myself, no help. My employees couldn't believe it. They'd never seen me do anything like that. But my wife had, she'd seen it. When I went into one of these modes, I get into the zone. I didn't even eat. You couldn't even get me to the table. I was just making my parts. And I crashed the car on the first run. That's over here. Let's go over this way. Again, this is all anodized aluminum to save weight. All this was built out there in that shop with my own two hands, every piece of it. And you see the wing is really up there. This puts that little wing in that nice, free, calm air. See, all this stuff causes the air to all be real disturbed in this area because the roll cage and all is coming through. But that's nice, free, calm air. And so that wing is really efficient up there. Well, I didn't know how much pressure that was putting down. I had no idea, but it's a lot. And this was made out of too thin a tubing. And at Phoenix, it all collapsed on the final run against Gary Beck. I won the race, but the car, and the wing collapsed on an angle like this, and it turned the car over. And it went upside down and skidded out in the desert. And it wasn't hurt too bad, but damaged enough you couldn't race it. So Johnny West has a shop there in Phoenix, and I knew Johnny West from years ago. So I went over to his house with a car and a trailer, and Johnny West was back east somewhere racing, and his mother was there. And I said, "I know Johnny real well. I got to get into his shop, and I got to use his stuff to fix my car." And she says, "I don't know whether he'd like that or not." I said, "Oh, he won't mind." Anyway, I convinced the old lady to let me into the shop. And we had to, and fortunately, he had the same kind of mill as me, the same kind of welder, and the same kind of lathe. So all the stuff was really handy. I knew everything, how to use everything. So me and the boys were well into repairing the car, and Johnny West rolled in. He says, "My God, what's going on here in my shop?" I said, "Johnny, I crashed at Phoenix, and I got to get to Pomona because I got this sponsorship, and I don't want to not make the first race." And he said, "It don't look too bad. Can I give you a hand?" I said, "Yeah, please do." So we all got it all put together, but it really needed a front half. It was kind of tweaked, but it was good enough to race. So we got beat by Amato at Pomona, and we come home and put a new front half on it. And we won the world championship in 85, and this car set the record at 268 miles an hour. And that's when I got the idea about Swamp Rat 30 with the little tiny front wheels and hiding these big wheels under a little canopy. And I built that car in the shop also, and it was the first car over 270 miles an hour. Gainesville went 272.56 and became the first car over 278. While I was building Swamp Rat 30, one of the curators from the Smithsonian come into the shop, and he said, "We heard you were building something special." And he said, "Is this it?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Sure, looks different." He said, "What are you gonna do with them front wheels?" I said, "I got this cover that's gonna go over them, the streamline it." He said, "When you're all done with this car, we'd like to have it for the Smithsonian." And I said, what an honor that is to have your car in the National Museum of American History. And 1987, when we finished with it, we put it in there, and it's still there. The car behind it right there is real special to me. That's Big Daddy Ed Roth's Yellow Fang. I found that in a museum in Nags Head, North Carolina. I gave $10,000 for that car. It's the only car that Ed Roth ever built that was for real racing. He built all these funny golf carts and all of these funny machines, but this was a real honest to God race car. And I was so happy to get that because that belongs here in the museum. I was offered $1.3 million for that car, and I wouldn't take it. I wouldn't take anything for it because I was a real big fan of Ed Roth. And when they called me the Big Daddy, he'd been the Big Daddy for years. I got on a plane and I flew out to California to his shop. I said, "They're calling me the Big Daddy in the press, Ed, but I'm not using that name because you're the Big Daddy." He's a big, heavy set guy. He said, "I may be the Big Daddy of custom cars," he said, "but you're the Big Daddy of drag racing for sure." And so that was it. I'm the Big Daddy of drag racing. And then I found this car, and it was so, God works in really strange ways. We were putting the finishing touches. The sign painter was here putting the Big Daddy Ed Roth Rat Fink sign on it. And who should walk in but the sun? And of course, Ed Roth was dead by now. And the sun is here on the grounds. He's got his booth out there. And he even looks kind of like him now. It's amazing. And he draws all the same kind of stuff. And it brought tears to his eyes. He says, "I was 15 years old when I had this car, and I used to polish it." And he said, "We never knew where it went." And I said, "Well, I found it in an old museum in Nags Head, North Carolina." I'm running out of steam. Anyway, we could go on here for days. Swamp Rat 19, I sold that to the Australians and brought it back. And look at these beautiful cars. Coletta, Cavasita. This is Cavasita's most beautiful car. Gary Cochran's. The Kreitzger and Donovan car. John Wiebe. Pete Robinson. I mean, this stuff is priceless. And all of these cars run. None of these cars are dummies. There's 2025. I'm gonna finish this tour with this car. In 1971, I went to Vietnam for President Nixon. I spent 16 days in Vietnam entertaining the troops. And I couldn't believe the miserable conditions that the kids had out in the front lines. And they were getting killed regularly because they would take property and then they'd come back. And then they'd take the property again and come back. And this one kid said to me, "Every time we take that hill, Big Daddy, one of my buddies gets killed. What bullet's got my name on it?" So when I got home, but the Navy guys, they were on their ships and they had machine shops and radio shops and electronics. They had real stuff to do that was interesting. So I got in my car and I drove to Washington. And I said, "I want to become a Navy recruiter. What do I do?" And they said, "Sign here." And we first job we did, we went out on the Lexington, that Swamp Rat 16 over there. and we did a Navy poster. And then this car here went on the Ranger. We did a Navy poster. And then, of course, the turbine car, we won the JFK. You see that. But in 1977, the Navy had given McEwen money. The Marines had given Mickey Thompson money. The Army had given Prudhomme money. And the Navy said, "We're going to give you some money. You don't have to be a volunteer. We want to put our name on your car in big letters." I had it down the cowl all the time, but they wanted it on the side. So when you got the side shots, it's Sea Navy. But they said, "You got to paint the car blue and white." I said, "Okay." And what we're going to do, we're going to put the signs on the car at Pomona in a celebration on the starting line. That's when the sticky signs had just come out, where it wasn't going to use sign painters. So the car's sitting in my garage. I'm getting ready to go to California. A beautiful white cow, and you can see some of the cows got ruts and stuff on them. And all of a sudden, something came to me. I should put a cross on the cow and put "God is love," the white. And so I drew a little cross on the concrete with a piece of chalk, and I measured it. I called the sign painter the next morning. They cut me out a cross. That's the cross right there. And I glued it on there. And I had my Dodge on there. But I go to California, none of the Big Daddy, none of that's there. It's all blank waiting for the Navy. Well, Shav Glick from the Los Angeles Times, he was a motorsports editor, he's dead now, came out into the pits. He always has a lot to say, he always likes to interview me. He says, "Where's your sponsor, Big Daddy?" I said, "The Navy's gonna come here and they're gonna put Navy on, they're gonna be my sponsor." "Oh, that's good." He's writing in his little tab. He said, what is this cross deal?" I said, I've had lots of wrecks and everything, and I've always survived, and I just thought I'd give God a little credit. I said, it's time he got a little credit for all that he done for me. "Oh, okay." So he goes back into the pits, and he interviews all the racers who are there. And every one of them, to the letter, never had anything nice to say about it. They said, "The old man ain't got any Navy sponsor, and it's cross, he's just looking for the Big Daddy sponsor in the sky. He's been breathing too much nitro fumes," and on and on. The next morning, the Los Angeles Times came out, and the sports page, under the header, they call it under the mask, letters that high, "Garland seeks Big Daddy sponsor in sky." And then it had the whole bottom page of everything that the racer said. This one said that, and this one said that. And I was always of the opinion, it don't matter what they say, just spell the name right. And they had the name spelled right. And you couldn't buy that space, "Garland seeks Big Daddy sponsor in sky." I mean, who knows how much that's worth, you know, because everybody sees that. And then they have to read the story. And there's an awful lot of Christians out there, and you can bet it didn't make points when they're making slurs about the Lord. So here comes the Navy, and they got the newspaper. And they said, "Have you seen the newspaper?" I said, "Yeah, ain't it wonderful?" I said, "Look at that. We got headlines that high under the mask." "Hey, no, we don't want that. This will upset atheists, and they won't want to join the Navy." I said, "Every ship has got a chapel on it." They said, "But we don't make them go in there." And he said, "This will run off recruits. We can't give you the money unless you take that cross off the cow." I said, "Look, I didn't come to you asking for any money. And you offered it to me. I am not taking the cross off the cow." "Then we're not going to give you the money." I said, "That's fine. Thank you very much. I'll still be a volunteer recruiter. I don't mind. I never wanted any money in the first place." This car won 24 national events out of 30 starts. There has never been a percentage like it. To this day, I hold the highest percentage of wins versus entered races. There's a lot of people won more races than me, but nobody entered the amount of races that I entered and won as high a percentage. And this car cost it. And it won over $600,000. Wow. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. God be with you. Who'd be against you?
Exactly.
My competitors hated this car. I ran it for 3 years. It was built in 77, and it got retired in 1980 when I entered this one. And this was, it was such a poor car versus this one. And it's never had anything done to it. It's just exact, as you can see here. We even stretched the wheelbase. The wheelbase used to be back here. You can see the fresh piece up here.
Unbelievable.
It was something else.
That's unbelievable.
Of course, it had some, I mean, I threw a few pieces off of it. I blew a clutch or two. Look at that clutch blew up. I blew a manifold up. It was something else. But any.
That's incredible.
I could go on and on. There's a story about every one of them in here. This is another special car. When I went to get the Yellow Fang in Nags Head, North Carolina, this car was in the museum too. They wanted $10,000 for it. It wasn't restored like this. It was kind of ratty looking. But I didn't have any, I only had a small trailer and I didn't have any more money anyway. And so, but I knew a friend of mine in California that really loved this car. And he always told me, if you ever find that car, let me know about it. And so I called him up. Riddell was his name. And he drove straight over to Nag's Head and got it. And something happened. He had some kind of a problem. And the man killed himself. And the wife knew that I did this kind of stuff, you know. And she said, my husband really was making that car to be put in a museum somewhere. And she said, I'd love to give it to you, but we need the money. You know, the husband's gone and we need the money. And she said, would you give $50,000 for the car? It needed to be finished. He done a lot of work. It had all the engine and everything done. I said, well, it is a lot of money, but I'll do it because this is a really important car. For one thing, it's the first, this was going to be a top fuel car, if you can believe that. And here it is, rear engine. Number two, Fred Smith was the designer and builder of this car. And I took Fred Smith out of Detroit, just out of high school. And he came to my shop and worked with me for years. And several of our cars has got lots of his work on them. And then he went to work for AMT, and he's dead now too. And I thought it'd be a nice tribute to have his work here in the museum where you can see what a smart guy he was. And Walt Stevens is a real good friend of mine. And then of course the paint by Gene Winfield. He's one of the most famous painters in the whole world. So here we got a piece of history that really should be in a museum. It was a lot of money to pay for it, but you know, the money is soon forgotten, and the legacy lives on.
Yeah.
I'm just going to have to call it a day, folks. I'm running out of steam, and probably you've heard enough for one night anyway. I don't know what time is it. How long?
I don't know.
How long?